Greetings. For today's installment of Take 5, I'm joined by Dr. Jean Bartoski-Wendy, SUNY Distinguished Professor and Dean of the School of Public Health and Health Professions. During UB's recent commencement exercises, I had the pleasure of awarding Jean the UB President's Medal for her outstanding work on the Women's Health Initiative. Thank you for your time, Jean. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm keeping busy as we all are and enjoying spring at least starting to come, but it's going fairly well.
Now, you have helped lead the Women's Health Initiative here at UB. Can you tell our audience a little about this initiative and its scope?
Yeah, sure. So the Women's Health Initiative, which I refer to as WHI, began a long time ago. Actually, we wrote this grant application in 1992. We were awarded it in 1993. So we are starting our 28th consecutive year of this program.
Wow.
The time, I think I was 2.5 years at the university. I was a young assistant professor. We had a team of people that applied to do this study. The study was really focused on some of the key issues in women's health, especially menopausal health. What were the risks and benefits of hormone therapy? What did we know about low-fat diet? And were calcium and D supplements helpful? And for all of these, we're interested in outcomes such as heart disease, cancer, osteoporosis, and many more. At the time, we enrolled 162,000 women, largest set of clinical trials ever done, I think, in the history of the world at that time. From Western New York, we enrolled 4,000 of those women, and UB became a leader from the start.
So I remember attending your talk a couple of years ago with our alumni and people from Buffalo in mm-hmm. Florida. And many of those who participated in your first group of women, they were there and they were so excited what you were able to achieve and how some of the therapy that was available, how you were able to really say that it's not effective. And so it was really amazing to see the people who participated in the first group of these yeah. women.
It was such an amazing story. In Western New York, at the time we had a press conference. It was maybe one of the largest studies UB had been involved with at the time. And that evening in the news, it went on, you know, channels 2, 4, and 7. And we got 700 calls in one day of women wanting to sign up. It took us a while even to get through those women. And these women have been remarkable. You're calling it my study, but it's actually their study because the women stepped up to do this. They have remained steadfast. We have a participant in our Buffalo site that's 103 years old, still mm-hmm. filling out her questionnaires and forms. And so it's the women who stood up
sure.
and have continued to do their remarkable job of helping us with this.
So, I mean, there are a lot of things that have come out from this study. As you said, one of the sort of largest group of women participating in study. In your opinion, what has been the most notable finding to emerge from this WHI?
So clearly, the most notable finding was the results of the hormone therapy trial, specifically the trial that looked at estrogen plus progestin as compared to placebo. And at the time, the notion was that hormone therapy was beneficial for many different diseases. Many were thinking of this as the fountain of youth. But there were some questions about its relationship with breast cancer. So when we planned the study, the plan assumed that there would be a benefit in heart disease and some other health outcomes, and there might be a risk of breast cancer, and we were weighing the balances and risks. what turned out to happen was hormone therapy was associated with increased risk of heart disease, of stroke, of pulmonary emboli, and of breast cancer. And the really only large benefit came to bone health. And so the balance of risks and benefits, just the risks outweighed the benefits. And so it was a marked worldwide change in prescriptions, ended up about half the total prescriptions in the world for hormone therapy reduced. There was an important finding. 10 years later, we evaluated the impact, and the estimation was that the reduction in community use resulted in about 120,000 breast cancers averted, another 80,000 heart disease, heart attacks were reduced, and also another 80,000 strokes and pulmonary emboli.
Right.
And so, you know, the human impact of that change, where we thought we were giving benefit and in fact providing a risk.
Right.
And ultimately, it was estimated that that stoppage in 10 years saved the economy $37 billion. So it was it was a study that, you know, really changed lives, changed practice. It really changed the world.
I mean, it sort of shows that the large studies are needed really for us to understand the real impact of these disease and these medicines actually. So, I mean,
right.
because people were prescribing these and thinking that they're going to be beneficial, and actually they were harmful. So this is
why we do randomized clinical trials. And in this case, a medication that was available for symptom management
right.
was, you know, overrated for its benefits. And it's very relevant today as we're talking about COVID and some of the medications that are out there, that we can't just put medications in use without doing these types of trials to understand the risks and the benefits.
So what's on the horizon for WHI?
So on the horizon, in the end of February, we wrote a renewal application, which would, if funded, and we're hoping it'll be funded, will take this study to the year 2027. So another 7 years of funding from where we are now. Ongoing, we have other randomized trials. So a group of our women, almost 50,000 that are still living and participating, are in the midst of a physical activity intervention trial to see the impact of that. We have a large sleep study ongoing. We're doing work in dementia. We in Buffalo have a large prospective study of the oral microbiome and periodontal disease. On top of the WHI, there are almost 300 NIH-funded studies that use the resource to expand what we know. And in fact, we're just about to submit a questionnaire that assesses the impact of COVID on this large national studies.
You know, this is amazing, the amount of data that you have, the resource that you have, mm-hmm. really is going to be useful for a lot more scientists who are not just looking at what you're looking at, but other problems. And as they find more discoveries, they can use the data that you have. Actually, fantastic.
Right. So we have blood samples over periods of time. So just being able to do genetic work, looking for blood biomarkers. In Buffalo, we've had dozens of our students train on this WHI resource, and probably 1,000 young investigators country and worldwide that have used some part of this data set.
Well, it really has been a pleasure talking to you, Jean. Thank you so much. And thank you for what you do in this project and as well as a public health researcher on the campus. Thank you.
I appreciate having the opportunity to talk about this great study.